In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If you're vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S.
In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do what? In these uncertain. In these uncertain economic times, you've got to do whatever you can to save money. One of our biggest expenses can be our cars, especially when unexpected repair bills hit. Not anymore. If you own a vehicle with less than 130,000 miles, is less than 12 years old, has a warranty about to expire, or even no warranty at all, you could stop paying for car repairs. Roadside assistance, towing, and rental coverage are all included. Don't wait for the next repair. Make one free call right now to see if you qualify. If your vehicle is less than 12 years old, has less than 130,000 miles, even if it's out of warranty, paying for car repairs can become a thing of the past. Call us right now and get your car protected before your next repair bill hits. Get protection and no more repair bills. Call 800-696-1030. Again, 800-696-1030. That's 800-696-1030. 800-696-1030.
Joe had huge problems with the IRS.
I knew it was coming. I hadn't filed taxes since 1990.
All the IRS letters coming in added up to a nightmare.
To get up to like $68,000, my heart started beating fast. It's like, there's no way, man. I mean, I ain't going to be able to do this.
Then they stopped his paycheck.
So that's when I started making phone calls and found U.S. Tax Shield.
U.S. Tax Shield went to work immediately.
They just took the bull by the horns. What blew my mind is he called the IRS right then and there.
So why is U.S. Tax Shield A-plus rated with the Better Business Bureau? Joe knows.
They saved me a ridiculous amount of money.
If you owe more than $10,000 to the IRS or state, choose the company Joe chose, U.S. Tax Shield.
It was the best decision I made. U.S. Tax Shield is the way to go. Life is good. Thank you, Laura.
Call 800-471-3287.
U.S. Tax Shield. Boo-rah. Yes.
800-471-3287. 800-471-3287.
I'm easy like Sunday morning. Wondering why you're up early with us on a Sunday morning making a cocktail? News lately got you drinking? Hung over from the mainstream media by Sunday? We are, and we got you covered.
We sure do. We got your hangover cure for those weekly news blues. So sit back, top off your mimosa, and add some Baileys to that coffee.
Take a match to your copy of the New York Times. Light, funny, and oh yeah, news with booze.
And a lot of laughter.
Welcome to Bloody Marys and Broadsheets. I paid my dues to make it.
Everybody.
And good Sunday morning, everybody, and welcome to Bloody Marys and Broadsheets. JD is still out on the West Coast. We have not had to send the recon team yet, though we have had reports, I believe Lou and myself have, of some shenanigans, shall we say. The cheeky and fun kind, not the tragic sort.
There we go.
What, Beaker?
Our shenanigans are cheeky and fun.
Yeah, I mean, his shenanigans are cruel and tragic.
Which makes them not shenanigans at all, really.
Evil shenanigans.
I swear to God, I'll pistol whip the next guy that says shenanigans.
Hey, Farva, what's the name of that restaurant you like with all the goofy shit on the walls and the mozzarella sticks?
You mean shenanigans?
No! Oh.
You're talking about shenanigans, right?
Put those away!
And Lou, who was going to play producer today, just became co-host because that's the third time we've lost Beaker.
Oh, I'm doing double duty. I'll try to Beaker a little.
You're doing double duty. All right.
I'll pretend
anyway,
the polyphone.
Good morning, everybody. And the wonderful Lou Bell is here with me today from R&R Radio. And we are going to talk about some really fun stuff. But before we get into the fun stuff, I did want to offer my personal and sincere condolences to a great lady in the conservative movement, Mary Catherine Hamm. Goes under MK Hammer on Twitter. We found out this morning that she actually lost her husband in an accident yesterday. He was riding in a cancer charity bike ride. I've had the pleasure of meeting Mary Catherine on several occasions at several different places. Truly one of the most gracious and kind, not to mention just intelligent and smart ladies in the movement. She and her young daughter, and what I'm understanding from news feeds today is she's actually pregnant with baby number two. Please keep them in your prayers along with the rest of her husband's family. 34 years old and really a tragic loss. So,
amen to that.
Yep. Prayer circles, folks. Prayer circles. That's what we do. All right, Lou, are you ready for the weekend update?
Yeah, I'm ready. It's going to be sad without Beaker, but maybe we'll get him back.
Maybe Beaker, get your internet up, dude.
Oh, I'll pretend to be polyphone.
Oh, there you go. You'll imitate him, right? All
yeah,
right, perfect.
Exactly.
Well, weekend update for September 20th, 2015. It was announced that Joe Biden may wait until late November to announce his run for the presidency. Republicans, anxious for the gaffe-prone VP to enter the race, have another name for his potential announcement, Thanksgiving.
Progressive fanatics at the University of California have announced a new public school policy banning what they deem to be any offensive act. They have announced that they will no longer be tolerant of intolerant behavior. For any student there who are not liberal, the new policy is making life at the school intolerable for those who are tolerant. Evidently.
There you go. Fed up with hearing potential presidential candidates slam the economy under his leadership, President Obama said they were lying and that any problems were the fault of others, not him. The president then stomped his feet, threw his papers on the ground, and ran out of the room crying.
Aw, President Stompy Feet. Debbie What's-Her-Name Schultz said this week she was thrilled that the Republican field was drowning out the Democratic primaries. The jury is out on just how thrilled Debbie will be when Republican votes drown out Democratic votes in next November.
The company that makes Doritos came out this week with their rainbow chips, supporting gay pride with brightly colored chips. The manufacturer of Doritos is also changing its name to Frito-Gay.
Frito-Gay, I love that. A former secretary for the Nobel Peace Prize says it was a mistake to give President Obama the prize just for getting elected and having good intentions. Years later, the secretary says Obama warrants nothing more than a participation trophy.
Which are very common on the left. And a Texas student made headlines this week when he was arrested for bringing what looked like a suitcase bomb to school. Liberals and President Obama are crying foul, saying the boy was racially profiled. However, chances are slim that Mr. Obama and the Secret Service will let the boy walk into the White House with a ticking suitcase with wires coming out of it on his upcoming trip there. And that is your weekend update for September 20th, 2015.
And I think that
Beaker,
last thing
we have you back.
Do we?
I see a Beaker, but I can't hear a Beaker. Well, we'll call him our silent third. How's that?
Yeah, he's our silent partner.
Our silent partner. Beaker is now the silent partner. All right. Well, Lou, so actually the last portion of the weekend update was the first thing we were going to start discussing today. Ahmed Mohammed, the 14-year-old who did or didn't build a clock, based on some of what we're seeing and some technology folks, it looks more like he broke a clock and reassembled a clock in his little suitcase. Took it to school and ended up having a teacher be somewhat upset by the appearance of it, and school police were called. With that, he was actually detained. They did handcuff him at 14, and he was taken from school to a detention center where his parents picked him up. The liberal outcry here has been just hysterical.
Hysterical is, I think, probably a... I'm sorry, did you want to hear from our friend on the left that has a differing opinion?
Well, you know, let's just go through some of the other support he's seen from the left. President Obama has invited the young man to a White House for his cool clock that he didn't really make. Zuckerman, the founder of Twitter, has invited him to have a Twitter internship. Hillary Clinton was hugely critical of the school and the school district. And of course, we are all being told that this was nothing more than racial profiling. However, Bill Maher, who I agree with on almost absolutely nothing other than the existential threat posed by radical Islam, had a different take on it. Lou?
I want to ask another question that's similar, but not about the same ethnic group. Mm-hmm. There was a big story this week about a 14-year-old Muslim American teenager in Texas who built a clock. He's a science kid, and that's great. Can we show the clock? Okay. And the people at the school thought it might be a bomb, perhaps because it looks exactly like a fucking bomb.
It doesn't look like a bomb.
And I noticed, you know, you were at the debate, and Jake Tapper was asking you about ISIS and important questions about terrorism, and he cut you off and said, "Excuse me, Governor, I have to talk about a 14-year-old who built a clock."
All right, I think that's about enough of that. He goes on and on and on.
And he does, and, you know, I think one of the things that he said is perhaps the child is due an apology, you know. We were wrong. It wasn't really a bomb, so let's apologize to the child and his family. But the meme of racial profiling, to me, in the current environment, and when you look at what some other children have been suspended from school for who are not Muslim Americans, really doesn't ring true for me. You know, you had a young child, I believe he was 7, who got suspended from school for chewing a Pop-Tart into a sort of gun shape and pretending to play with it with his classmates. His parents actually spent a year in court fighting the suspension, as way overkill, and had to pay attorneys and a whole bunch of other things. They wanted it removed from his record. That student was white. Alex Stone, a 16-year-old white kid from Somerville, South Carolina, wrote a short story in which he imagined using a gun to kill a dinosaur. For this, his locker was searched, and he was arrested, handcuffed, and charged with disorderly conduct and suspended from school for 3 days. In Dyer County, Tennessee, Kendra Turner says she was suspended for saying "bless you" after a student sneezed, and that teacher told her that she would have no godly speaking in class.
I remember these students, that story.
Yeah, these students, I mean, we have kids being suspended for wearing American flag t-shirts. We have kids being suspended for wearing Confederate flag t-shirts. You know, Lynyrd Skynyrd concert tee. Ooh, the racism. You know, and all of a sudden we have this huge media outcry over this kid who literally bought a bunch of wires and a timer in a suitcase to school.
Yeah, I'm
who
pretty
does
sure,
that?
Well, I'm pretty sure if I assembled something that looked like that suitcase, which it resembles a suitcase bomb, I mean, obviously, that you can look in it and see that there's no explosive in there. So, you know, that was obvious. But to me, it looks like a bomb that's missing nothing but the C4. If I had assembled that and taken it anywhere, I'm pretty sure, white and female, I'd be in jail. And nobody would be coming.
You think you could have gotten it through, like, TSA?
TSA, maybe. I could have gotten it through TSA.
They'd have let you walk right through with your suitcase bomb while they wand a 95-year-old grandma in a wheelchair, you know?
Right. They'd just hand you C4 on the way out the gate.
There's Beaker! Yay!
Beaker, you're here! Yay!
Gun is to Pop-Tart as clock bomb is to what?
You know, I mean, if you take a look at it, number one, as a parent with children in school, if my child's teacher even suspected that somebody had a valid weapon in the school building, I would expect them to act. Number two, when you take a look at the entire story, including those that have broken down his clock and said it was a complete fabrication, you know, you start to wonder what the actual intention is. His father's from Sudan. His father tried to run for president of Sudan several times, and he has also been a Quran activist in the past. Not saying anything other than this appears to be to me, and it was actually interesting because Lou, on the audio you played, I forget the journalist who had actually interviewed the young boy on the phone, but he could actually hear his older sister giving him answers from behind him.
This stinks.
It doesn't smell. That was my comment. It doesn't pass the smell test, period.
Well, now his father is saying he will be withdrawn from the school. He's getting offered scholarships from private schools in Texas. He gets to go to the White House. What is that?
It's amazing how quickly the president responded to all this off of Twitter. Because usually, you know, it takes him a couple days to learn about news events, like big ones, through the news cycle. But boy, he was right on top of the whole Ahmed thing, which I guess when he wants to learn something, he can learn something on his own.
Right, without the news media telling him. Right, exactly.
Well, and I mean, seriously, to kind of further that whole idea, never reached out to Kate Steinle's family. They weren't brought to the White House or the victim of any other significant crime by an illegal immigrant. The families of police officers who have been assassinated, literally assassinated while doing things as nefarious as pumping gas, no word on these folks. You know, there was actually a video out there of a young man who's about 13 years old, happens to be African-American, and really took Obama to task for using tragedy to advance his political agenda. So my thought is, if a 13-year-old can see it, why can't our liberal media see it? Why can't... Sorry, Beat, go ahead.
I said because emotionally they're dealing with a younger age set there?
I would guess so, but I mean, my whole thing is this. Schools have implemented zero tolerance policies for silly, 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 silly things like saying God bless you. If schools have truly adopted zero tolerance policies, bringing something to school that looks dangerous has to be addressed, whether you're brown, white, black, purple, or green. It really doesn't matter. It's a zero tolerance policy. And if you look at the young man's YouTube video, he even says he tied it up so it would look less threatening. He wasn't unaware of what he had just constructed and what it might resemble.
Now, the interesting thing is, had this kid been in Yemen, instead of a White House invitation, Obama would have sent a drone up his ass.
That's a good point,
well,
Baker.
That was one of the points that, you know, Bill Maher actually made on his show. Again, I agree with Bill Maher about nothing other than the existential threat posed by radical Islam. But he said, you've got teenagers leaving Mississippi, leaving Great Britain to go fight with ISIS. The kid is 14 years old. And oh, by the way, maybe if these folks didn't have a 30-year history of blowing stuff up, people might not But I would say, I would honestly say, if a child brought any case with wires and a timer that looked dangerous, I don't know that it would have mattered what religious background or color he was. I honestly don't believe, at least with some of the stories we've seen, Pop-Tart guns, that it would have been handled any differently.
Well, let's not forget that a boy was just, wasn't he just called or charged with sexual assault for kissing a 13-year-old girl in a dare? And people are going to bitch about this? I mean, should the kid been put in cuffs? No. But should the police have been there? Yeah. It's fairly clear. If there is a threat, if there's something that they think might be a threat, and they don't act on it, and something goes wrong, I mean, I understand there's somewhat of a fine line. We don't want to knee-jerk at everything, but there was some suspicion there. You might as well take a look at it. Now, again, do I agree that the kid should have been carted off in handcuffs? No.
But the situation certainly warranted further investigation. I mean, I don't believe most school teachers are bomb experts.
It certainly
wires and a timer. It looks suspicious.
Well, right. I mean, it takes the explosive, right? So there's clearly no explosive in there, but that's not really the point.
That's not their job to dig that thing apart and see, you know, where could it be? And
that's not the point.
Well, he had gone through a couple of different classes, and a teacher told him to put it away because people might be scared by it. And he refused to comply.
So, again, not passing the smell test, what was their objective? He has an activist father, he's a 14-year-old kid, and his sister's obviously feeding him answers for the press.
Mm-hmm.
I
think the overblown reaction to it, to me, is just a reinforcement of the identity politics that this White House has played since day one. And it's really, you know, its really only purpose was to create further division, especially in a state like Texas, where, you know, Irving, Texas has seen a certain amount of Sharia law, honor killings, and some other things. Mm-hmm. People are a little bit more on notice. And it's not that far from Garland, Texas, where Pam Geller held her event and two jihadists showed up. So I think there's a big meme there about both the state of Texas being Islamophobic, as well as, you know, persecution and you know, racial profiling of young children that I honestly just don't believe exists, given some of the things we've seen school suspensions for.
And I think you're talking about the context. I think the context is very important. I think that's what Bill Maher, you know, was talking about. And you have to add Oklahoma into that too. And when you look at Texas and Oklahoma and the terrorist activity that's taken place there, the attacks that have taken place there, put in context the fear and of the police in general, the planning of the police in general, and then you have to take all of that into context when you look at this. And I guarantee you, any other person, any other situation would not have gotten an invitation to the White House.
Absolutely not. I don't remember the little boy with the Pop-Tart gun having anybody feel sorry for him.
No.
You know, and when it comes, you know, let's just go out and say, From the supposition that the kid was just being a jackass kid, like jackass kids are. I mean, I was 14 and I was a jackass. So, you know,
and what's changed? No, I'm just kidding, Beaker. I'm kidding.
Not much. they're yanking somebody's chain, which is fine. But it, you know, two parts to this. One, from a propaganda perspective, this is perfect because it also pushes the whole, you know, STEM agenda, science and technology, mathematics, blah, blah, blah. So it's almost tailor-made for press. Oh, look, we can get more, you know, science. Science is great. Let's push this on the science front. But I tell you, if this kid did what it kind of looks like and just disassembled a clock and stuck it in a case and he's really not a science geek, I feel very, very badly for him, because he's going to go to all these places and they're going to expect him to do things that if he's not prepared to do as far as being a science geek and show science geekiness, he's going to get eaten alive. And I would feel, I'd feel bad for him.
I think that's the funny part.
He doesn't have a lot of projects in his room that show a lot of wires attached to things. He was very happy to show them on the YouTube video. But here's just in wrap up my message to Ahmed. Nice clock. Nice try. Not buying it. Doesn't pass the sniff test.
There you go.
And with that, we're going to go to break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about Donald, his little faux pas, his Sunday morning rebound or attempted rebound, and some
cheeky shenanigans?
Cheeky shenanigans.
All right. We'll be right back.
The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
If you like your health care plan, you'll be able to keep your health care plan. This is the most transparent administration in history. Not even a smidgen of corruption.
Fact is, we had 4 dead Americans. What difference at this point does it make?
If you've got a business, you didn't build that.
The feeling most people get when they hear a Barack Obama speech, I felt this thrill going up my leg. I don't have that too often.
Steady.
It's time to hear the truth about America's biggest challenges. Ricky Robinson, host of America Off the Rails, will tackle the important issues facing America today as he tries to keep America from coming off the track. Get ready to hear the truth every Monday through Friday starting at 7 p.m. Eastern, 6 Central, here on K98Talk.com and the Spark Radio Network.
Red Nation Rising brings you Town Hall Radio.
From a single tweet to 3 million a month, our community is a force to be reckoned with on social media.
So don't miss our show, Thursdays, 8 p.m. Eastern on K98 Talk.
Our chat room is our co-host, and you ask the question.
Join us and be heard.
So get ready to sound off on Red Nation Rising Radio. No one else is going to do it for you.
K98Talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98Talk.com.
And welcome back to Bloody Marys and Broadsheets here on a lovely Sunday morning in my neck of the woods. Climbing up on 11:30, and I am here this morning with Lou from Red Nation Rising Radio, who you can hear live every Thursday night at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on Red Nation Rising Radio, and Beaker O'Donovan, who you can normally find in our chat room collecting panties. Right, Beep?
Lou.
So, Donald did a speech in New Hampshire, and people that everybody are saying was probably a Dem plant, I actually doubt that because there are a fair number of folks on the right who do actually believe this, asked him a question about Muslim terrorist camps in the U.S., which, oh, by the way, have been verified by any number of news sources, legitimate ones at that, and also how he felt about having a Muslim in the White House. Donald gave a non-answer, did not correct him on Obama's supposed religion or background, and has taken a beating in the liberal press. And guys, I have to say this. This is one where I got to agree with Donald.
Blind squirrel. I do too.
I mean, in reality, you know, as much as I would like to go drink a cup of bleach after saying that out loud, he is under no obligation to defend the president. When Hillary Clinton called everybody who was conservative a terrorist, I didn't see Barack Obama rushing to correct her.
Nope.
When people, you know, call the Tea Party, you know, the greatest threat to national security, according to the DHS, I don't see Barack Obama correcting that with any factual information about Tea Party rallies and Tea Party organization or
How
even conservative
Harry
organizations. So I'm really struggling to figure out why people I consider to be very smart, including Ron Fournier, getting on there and saying he was somehow morally obligated to correct that statement about the President of the United States. You know, I mean, do I personally believe he's Muslim? I believe he has Muslim family members. I believe his father was Muslim. The only thing I know about his religious background is that he spent over 15 years in what is probably one of the most racist radical churches in the city of Chicago. I'd almost prefer he was a Muslim than under the tutelage of Jeremiah Wright. But, you know, at the same time, I don't think Donald did anything wrong there.
Well, think about Harry Reid and what he said on the floor of the Senate in a legislative context about not just the Koch brothers, but another presidential candidate, Mitt Romney. And did President Obama ever defend, ever deny, ever, you know, chastise Harry Reid, who now admits that those were lies and he basically made them up and pulled them out of his what, Beaker?
Buttocks.
Yes, thank you.
You know, in context, I do not believe for one second that Donald Trump was under any obligation, and I actually believe that his Twitter response yesterday was correct. If I were him, I would have stuck with it. That's not what he did.
No, I don't think so. I don't think he stuck with it. I think he should have
been
firmer.
All over the Sunday talk shows talking about how he loves Muslims. Muslims love him. He's very popular with the Muslims. And he would definitely pick a Muslim running mate or put a Muslim in his cabinet.
He knows terrific Muslims.
He knows terrific Muslims. Muslims are great.
Okay, terrific.
Yeah. The worst part of Trump's speech was not him failing to defend Barack Obama. It was everything else about it. I actually watched it. A lot of, I'm going to be great. I'm going to be terrific. I'm going to do, you know, the right thing. And you're never going to see anything as terrific as what I'm going to do. Blah, blah, blah. No specifics. None at all. Failed to answer the questions that were actually being asked in the town hall. You know, one woman got up and asked him about the family court system. He clearly knows nothing about it and answered a completely different question. Another person got up and asked him about the economy and what he would actually do to fix it. And we get the standard, I'll be the greatest jobs president God ever made. There is no substance there. And that's what just kills me about people flocking to these speeches. It's a lot of angry language, a lot of calling current government, you know, representatives stupid and idiotic, a lot of calling his, you know, competitors stupid and idiotic, but I heard nothing substantive in that entire speech. It was 42 minutes long, by the way, so I think I deserve, I don't know, a round just for listening to it.
Stacy, again, takes one for the team.
Always takes one for the team.
Always. I haven't heard anything substantive in a lot of what he says, so I can't say that that speech was really different. And I know you would agree, Stacy.
Yeah. Well, and that was reflected post-debate. First post-debate poll came out today with from CNN ORC. There was one yesterday. People want to say, "Oh, this is EGOP, and they're strategizing, and they're trying to shove a candidate down your throat." But somebody actually went, and I believe the number was it was more than 2,500. I want to say it was somewhere around between 2,700 and 2,800 Republican primary voters in New Hampshire. So the target audience was very specific. And it's a bigger number surveyed than you see in most national polls, okay? So they went out and did this just for New Hampshire voters yesterday, and Carly Fiorina was leading with 22%. The Trumpers went nuts! It's a conspiracy! So CNN ORC comes out with a poll today, which I say it'll probably be better assessed once you see some other polls and some kind of trend line through the RCP average or something, shows Donald Trump fell 8 points to 24%, and shows Fiorina, I believe, at 15 and Carson at 11. Now, what's even more stunning than that is when you look at the number of voters for people like Rubio and Fiorina, nearly 30% of the population has never heard of them. Now, I think those people should be barred from voting altogether, but that's just my own personal fascist opinion. I think if you're not going to participate as a citizen, you should just shut up.
Yeah.
But, so if you actually do the math, both Rubio and Fiorina have 21 and 22% respectively of the people who know who they are. So Donald only has 1% of the population that doesn't know who he is. I think they find them under a rock. And then he gets 24% out of almost 100% of the population, whereas Fiorina and Rubio get early 20s for the percent of the population that know who they are. I think we're going to see some differences here in the post-debate polling kind of across the board. I think that RCP average is going to start to move.
Well, that's what people...
asking me to do math. I'm
I have to do math for the morons on Twitter.
This is what people who watch this year after year, decade after decade, like you and I, Stacey, have been predicting. This is how elections go. It's nothing
new. Well, and
I love posting
the RCP average from 2012.
Right.
It's all over the place. And you can clearly see in that September-October timeframe, people leave the silly season, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they actually start to get serious and start looking at candidates. And candidates go up and down and up and down and up and down and up and down.
Yep.
This is not unusual, but what I found two unique things. Number one, well, three, actually. Number one, the number of people who don't know who Fiorina and Rubio and even Carson are, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And number two, the fact that Donald, I think, also reached peak likability. His likability scores among Republicans went way up. Now they're starting to come down again. And I think it's a lot of his ad hominem attacks on people whose likability scores were higher than his.
Not one of his brighter moves, just saying.
No, I mean, with the likability scores that Carson and Fiorina had, I think he just should have left that alone. And I think it's going to get more perilous for him as he goes forward.
Which is, I think, why he's been going out of his way to make nice with Fiorina. I think he's recognized that he's stepped on it, but I think he's pathologically incapable of not attacking.
Well, he's also pathologically incapable of any type of sincerity. I mean, everything he says is like licking your finger and sticking it in the air to see which way the wind is blowing. Oops, they didn't like that I said that about Carly, so now I'm going to say she's pretty. What?
Right.
Nobody sitting at home believes that. Nobody.
And it's all about him.
Well, and I think part of what you're seeing in his likability is women.
Yeah. Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. We have kind of a higher standard of behavior.
Yeah, and they're also 52% of the electorate.
Mm-hmm. Right.
The other interesting thing that happened in his New Hampshire speech is this adorable little girl, Beaker, you're going to love this, stood up and said, Mr. Trump, when do we get to meet your first lady?
Let me show you the video, kid.
He didn't answer.
Okay, terrific.
Maybe he didn't hear it, right?
No, he heard it. He responded, but he never answered. He said, oh, isn't that cute? And then just moved on. Do you think maybe he's picking up on the fact that his wife might be a liability with female voters?
Maybe.
Perhaps.
And I do not personally know Mrs. Trump. She may be the nicest woman in the whole world. But, I mean, conservatives would not tolerate that from any other candidate.
Optics.
And that's a great point. You were making this earlier, Stacey, and that's a really great point because that is what hurts you over time. So as time goes by, voters look closer and closer. They look back at those optics from earlier in the campaign. They take you, as they get more serious, they take you more seriously. It's hard to take Donald seriously.
Oh, people are like, he has charisma. He had a top-rated TV show. I said, so do the Kardashians. There's no accounting for taste.
And Charlie Sheen.
Charlie Sheen. You know, the fact that only 1% of America does not know who he is speaks volumes to me from a polling perspective of why he has trended so high to begin with.
Yeah.
You know, I would say Lou, Beaker, myself, most of the folks in our chat room are highly likely voters. Highly likely to vote in a primary, highly likely to vote in a general. We all voted in off-year elections, right?
Yep.
I have never been called, ever. I've never been polled.
Yeah, me neither.
Lou?
Yeah, I actually have, and I'll admit to messing with them. From time to time.
Well, yeah. I think the polls over the next couple days are going to be something interesting to watch. Trump went right back to his rhetoric today on the Sunday shows of calling Fiorina boring and difficult to listen to. So we'll see how that plays. In addition, showed up at the Faith and Freedom group in Iowa with a Bible in his hand. He's playing you. Mm-hmm. Anyway, with that, we're going to take our second break. We'll be back in just a few minutes. And when we get back, Rainbow Doritos and a couple of other funnies that have hit the press.
Skittles
back in a couple minutes.
Skittles is pissed.
Hey everybody, this is Jason, host of According to Me. I'd like to invite you to check out my show. It's a two-hour show that lasts 60 minutes in...
Listen, I hate to interrupt, but one thing I can do is read off a script. Just say, let me be clear a lot. It works.
President Obama, I can handle this. It's a radio promo. I'm not green. I've done this before.
Did someone say green?
Now, Al Gore is here. Listen, I'm just trying to record a radio promo. Do you mind?
Now, do you say good things about me on the show?
No, not at all. But if it makes you feel any better, I rip on Republicans just as much.
The AM radio frequencies give off very high levels of radiation.
Look, my show show is on the internet, which you invented. Can I just do my promo?
I got a pen. I can veto that, you know.
I know you got a pen. It's not a law. It's a radio promo. Listen, just listen to my show. Barack Obama and Al Gore hate it, so you're going
to
love it.
Here's an executive order. Don't listen to a show. He doesn't like me. He's racist.
And he doesn't recycle either.
That's it. I'm done. It's According to Me, Wednesdays, 10 p.m. Eastern, right here on K98 Talk.
We will never fully understand what we've asked of our military service members or their families, asking them to put themselves in harm's way, to endure it all. But we do understand that it's our turn, our duty, to keep them secure for the rest of their lives. Wounded Warrior Project long-term support programs help our most severely ill or injured veterans live independently, at no cost, for life, so that they might stand at ease. Join us at findwwp.org.
K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at sales@k98fm.com.
Welcome back. It's Sunday morning. I am so happy this morning to have Lou, Red Nation Rising Radio, and our good friend Beaker on the phone with me. So guys, interesting story this week. Frito-Lay has decided to partner with a gay rights organization, and for a small donation of $10 or more, you get mailed a bag of rainbow-colored tortilla chips called Doritos.
Does anybody remember Schmidt's Gay?
No.
Oh my god, it's an old SNL skit with I think it's Chris Farley and oh god, Adam Sandler.
Okay.
When it's, oh god, I wish I could cue it up. It's, they need to be eating this, the new Doritos at a Schmidt's Gay party. It was, oh well, anyway, I hate it when I tell a joke and I don't have the context, but boring. Sorry, I'll just shut up.
No, but have you seen these things?
Yes, they look like a unicorn took a crap in a plastic bag, but sure.
Oh my god, what kind of dye did they have to use to make purple Dorito chips?
That just can't be good for you.
At all. Or maybe they just added some red to some blue corn? I don't know. But I mean, the colors on these things, Lou, you said it before break, Skittles is pissed. The colors on these things look just like Skittles.
Uh-huh. Nice, Lou.
It's corn Skittles.
Oh my god. I looked at them and I'm like, you know, if those were ever available for regular sale and I saw my kids eating a bag, I would like rip them out of your hands.
Taste corn, the rainbow.
SG.
Oh my god.
I know. And what kind of, that's the thing. You know, what do they have in them? What kind of dye? What do they have to do to this corn to make it? And I mean, the thing that you won't hear liberals say is, you know, let us see the ingredients of the dye because it's for a good cause.
It's for narrative. But, you know, when I was growing up, Cool Ranch was a big deal, right? When they came out with Cool Ranch Doritos, that was pretty awesome stuff. This, I just looked at and I went, ew! Gross.
Yeah. Well, they're not a special flavor, are they? What flavor are they anyway?
I'm not touching that one.
I'm not even going to go there, Lou. Thank God JD's not here.
I know JD is going to be really disappointed in me for not just,
just
that one, but
going
I just
there. Same midgets or something. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. Anyway, and that was not the only news on the LGBTQ movement this week, was it, Beaker?
No, new Secretary of the Army. The big headline was the first openly gay. You know, who cares what somebody's sexual orientation has to do with their ability to do anything? I have no idea.
Me either. Here is my only question. I don't care what you do. I don't care who you love. I never have. Can you run the army? It's a freaking mess. It is at its lowest readiness statistics since before World War II.
Exactly.
Can I give you what my theory is on this?
Sure.
They have been trying to piss off the Army and the Rangers for years, especially the Rangers. For whatever reason, liberals hate airborne. And from the time they took their beret and gave it to the rest of the Army, they've been trying to piss these guys off. The last person on Earth I would try to piss off is an airborne Ranger, FYI. And I think it's just another attempt to piss the troops off. That's just me.
Well, as if they don't have enough to be pissed off about, Lou.
Mm-hmm.
Over a decade of war in the Middle East, suicide rates that are out the roof, rates of PTSD, a VA that can't function for them, nor provide the support they need when they come home from doing their job in, oh, by the way, what is an all-volunteer army. Okay? I mean, they have dozens of reasons and dozens of things a liberal administration has done to piss them off.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and not just the army. Yeah, and not just the army. The Navy and the whole aviation community is livid at them taking naval aviators that are our bravest men, because they land jets on aircraft carriers. I mean, if you've ever seen one, it's like a football field to land a Mach 3 jet on. And they're sending them loaded with bombs over Syria, and they're coming back loaded with bombs because they won't. Stacy, they have done so many things to piss them off, to make them feel undervalued, like they don't matter.
Well, and I mean, I'm just sitting here and, you know, I'm getting really tired of participation trophies in life. I don't care if you're gay. I don't care what color you are. I don't care where you grew up. I don't care really what you've done to this point in life. If you're going to take a position or a post over something as critical to our self-defense as Secretary of the Army, I just want to know that you're qualified. I don't care that you're the first anything. I really don't. You know, what are you going to have a t-shirt made? Hi, I'm the first gay Secretary of the Army. So what? What did you do?
if you were, you know, I'll even take it to the other extreme. If he were the first combat double amputee person in this position, that would still be a question. It's what qualifies you for the job? It's not what badges you wear in that respect. And I'm not trying to infer that that's a badge. And I didn't really, at any rate, it's, what are your qualifications? I don't care what you're first at. I don't care at all what you're first at. It's, again, what are you qualified to do? And I just don't like it seeing being led. It seems, at least when you read the story, this seems like it's a component of it, and it has no business being a component of it.
Exactly.
It's a pattern with this administration. They want to have the first everything.
Well, this administration won't have the first female president, and I think that's half the reason Barack is trying to torpedo Hillary. He knows another first after him will take some of the shine off. Not a lot of the shine hasn't already left, but...
That's a good point.
Speaking of Obubu and things that he just probably shouldn't do, it seems that now people have actually asked him to use the RICO statute to prosecute scientists who don't believe in climate change.
Yeah. That's
yeah.
A really good idea, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, because God knows we wouldn't want people doing research to try to verify things. I think the last thing I saw like the average change in temperature globally for the last 20 years was like less than 0.2 degrees, totally within the margin of error. And I mean, this was a conglomeration of dozens and dozens and dozens and dozens of tests. But apparently these 20 climate scientists who believe this science is so settled have suggested that Obama do what they did to the tobacco companies for covering up the health effects for cigarettes, because anti-climate change scientists are threatening all of our health.
So here's the thing. RICO is a conspiracy statute.
Mm-hmm.
And if there is a conspiracy, I think the evidence falls on the side of the climatologist and the climate change crowd rather than the anti-climate change crowd. The evidence is there. They've been found out. And so it's crazy hypocrisy to me for them to say those guys are conspiring when they're the ones that are obviously conspiring. That's insane.
Well, and it flies in the face of science. There's very little settled science in this world. And unless Barack Obama and his baby-killing friends over at Planned Parenthood would like to take the science that is out there in embryology and when life actually begins very seriously, I see no obligation to look outside and say, oh, weather, that's what it is. It's weather.
Yeah, it's crazy.
The thing that disturbs me the most about that is let's enforce the thought police here.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not the only place.
Let's get the legal arm of the thought police going and just make sure that this doesn't, you know, aberrant thought will not be tolerated. If you doubt the status quo, then, you know, this takes the Alinsky tactics and ups them a little bit.
Oh, but, you know, sue a baker, put a florist out of business, jail a county clerk in Kentucky. Now we're going to put scientists up under RICO charges. I cannot wait until January 20th of 2017. I don't know about you guys.
I can't wait either, but I tell you, if it was happening on the other side, if anything similar was happening on the other side, it would be McCarthyism.
Absolutely. Yeah. And with that fun thought, folks, thank you so much for joining us this Sunday morning. JD will be back on Tuesday. I'm sure he will have all kinds of interesting stories to tell. And don't forget, our own JD is going to be on with friend of the show, Michael Loftus. If you don't get the Flipside show in your market yet, the episodes are actually replayed on the website, so we will let you all know when it comes up so that you can see JD on TV. How weird is that going to be?
That's going to be awesome. I can't wait to see JD on TV.
Neither can I. And I hear rumors of, like, possibly having confirmed maybe a cruise with maybe even an additional person on the boat. So as soon as we get some of those things settled down, we will let you all know. And until then, have a wonderful rest of your Sunday. And thank you, Lou and Beaker, for joining me this morning.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
If it's Sunday, it's Bloody Marys and Broadsheets.
We're your cure from your weekly news hangover.
Thank you for taking it easy with us. You can find our show account on Twitter at JD and Stacy, or send us your interesting news story of the week to GameOnWar, that's WAAR, at gmail.com.
And you can find me on Twitter at ScottsFire and on Facebook at Stacy Lennox.
And you can find me on the Twitters at GameOnJD.
When our water heater broke down last month, it was a nightmare. It took 5 hours for the plumber to show up, and he charged us a couple of $100 just to come out. Then it cost another $1,800 to put in the new water heater. By the time it was all said and done, I felt like I'd been taken. But what else could I do?
The smartest thing you can do is get a home warranty from American Residential Warranty. Their home warranties pay to repair or replace all your major appliances when they break. And they will break, and at the worst possible time. Call American Residential Warranty right now for free information on home warranties starting at just pennies a day. Don't wait for your refrigerator to stop running or your ceiling fans to stop turning. Call American Residential Warranty right now. Ask how you can save up to 50% on washer and dryer coverage. Just call 1-800-513-6154. That's 1-800-513-6154. Again, 1-800-513-6154. Call now.
Tired of paying outrageous prices for Viagra? Well, we have great news for you. Now you can finally get Viagra at huge discounts. Healthy Man allows you to save up to $500 on Viagra. Why pay U.S. pharmacy prices of $15 per pill or more when you can get Viagra for less than $3 a pill? Call today and get 40 Viagra pills for only $99. This can cost as much as $600 at your local pharmacy. You can't afford not to call us. If you want Viagra at the lowest prices, never pay $15 a pill pharmacy prices again. Get Viagra for less than $3 a pill. Call 1-800-516-7602 today and save up to $500 and get 40 pills for just $99. Healthy Man is fast, easy, and affordable. Operators are waiting at 1-800-516-7602 to take your call right now. Call 1-800-516-7602. That's 1-800-516-7602. Again, 1-800-516-7602.